Being Reformation Sunday, I just wanted to recap on a little bit of history of Martin Luther, if that is okay with you all. Martin Luther was born in Eisleben, Germany in 1483. Martin Luther went on to become one of the Western historians, history's most significant figures. He spent his early years in relative anonymity as a monk and a scholar. But in 1517, Luther penned a document attacking the Catholic Church, corrupt practices of selling indulgences to absolve sin. And I hope you all know what indulgences is. Tetzel was the one who promoted, articulated it. The indulgences is basically a remission of sins before God of temporal punishment due to sins whose guilt has already been forgiven, which the faithful Christian who is duly disposed gains under certain prescribed condition through the action of the church, which as the minister deems right and fit, he gives them a certain amount. And the indulgences came into force because the Pope was wanting to build St. Peter's Basilica, and he was raising money for it. He was selling forgiveness of sin through these indulgences. And Martin Luther's 95 theses, which propounded two central beliefs that the Bible is the central religious authority, and that humans may reach salvation only by the faith and not by deeds. And this was the spark of fire that was lit by Martin Luther, and that set the Reformation, Protestant Reformation. Although these ideas had been advanced before, Martin Luther codified them at a moment in history ripe for religious reformation. The Catholic Church was ever after divided, and Protestantism that soon emerged was shaped by Luther's ideas. His writing changed the course of the religious and cultural history in the West. Martin Luther, he was born in 1483, he died in 1546, was born in Eisleben, Saxony, now Germany, part of the Holy Roman Empire, to parents Hans and Margareta. Luther's father was a prosperous businessman. When Luther was young, his father moved a family of 10 to Mansfield. At age 5, Luther began his education at a school where he learned reading, writing, and Latin. At 13, Luther began to attend school run by the Brethren of Common Life in Marburg. The Brethren's teaching focused on personal piety. While there, Luther developed an early interest in monastic life. This is not the Brethren that we have today, that was started by J.N. Darby, that was in 1800s. This is a Roman Catholic Brethren movement that was there, the Brothers of Common Life. And Martin Luther entered the monastery as he had a desire to study theology, but Hans Luther had other plans for Martin. He wanted him to become a lawyer, so he withdrew him from school in Marburg and sent him to a school at Eisenach. Then in 1501, Luther enrolled at the University of Erfurt, the premier university in Germany at that time. There he studied the typical curriculum of the day, arithmetic, astronomy, geometry, philosophy. He attained a master's degree from school in 1505. In July of that year, Luther got caught in a violent thunderstorm in which a bolt of lightning nearly struck him down. He considered the incident a sign from God and vowed to become a monk if he survived the storm. The storm subsided. Luther emerged unscathed, and true to his promise, Luther turned his back on his study of the law days later on July 17, 1505. Instead, he entered an Augustinian monastery. And this is how God works divinely in people's lives to meander the paths to do what he wills and what he wants. And I believe this was this was the work of God. Luther began to live the Spartan and rigorous life of a monk, but did not abandon his studies between 1507 and 1510. Luther studied at the University of Erfurt and at the University of Wittenberg. In 1510 to 1511, he took a break from his education to serve as a representative in Rome for the German Augustinian monastery. In 1512, Luther received his doctorate, became a professor of biblical studies. Over the next 5 years, Luther's continuing theological studies would lead him to insights that would have implication for Christian thought for centuries to come. In the early 16th century, some theologians and scholars were beginning to question the teaching of Roman Catholic Church. It was also around this time that the translations of the original text, namely the Bible and writings of the early church philosopher Augustine, became more widely available. Augustine, who lived between 340 and 430 AD, had emphasized the primacy of the Bible rather than church officials as the ultimate religious authority. He also believed that humans could not reach salvation by their own acts, but that only God would bestow salvation by his divine grace. In the Middle Ages, the Catholic Church taught that salvation was possible through good works or works of righteousness that please God. And let me pause here. And today, even in the church, even today, we judge people by the good works that they do. And then we say, he or she is saved. We are still Roman Catholic in our mind in many cases. That is, Roman Catholicism and their doctrine actually appeals to the fallen man, because that is of what salvation. Though people may say, oh, I'm not a Roman Catholic, but still the thinking is like the Roman Catholic, because the source is the same, the fallen flesh and depravity from which all these things come out. Luther came to stare Augustine's two central beliefs, which would later form the basis of Protestantism. Meanwhile, the Catholic Church's practice of granting indulgences to provide absolution to sinners became increasingly corrupt. Indulgences selling had been banned in Germany, but the practice continued unabated. In 1517, a friar named Johann Tetzel began to sell indulgences in Germany to raise funds to renovate St. Peter's Basilica in Rome. Now, this, and then you had the worship of relics. And you had all these things put together really made Martin Luther to think about it and to see what the church was doing was basically destroying the people of God. Martin Luther was committed to the idea that salvation could be reached through faith and by divine grace only. Luther vigorously objected to the corrupt practices of selling indulgences. Acting on this belief, he wrote the Disputation on the Power and Efficacy of the Indulgences, which is known as the 95 Theses. This was the actual title of his 95 Theses, Disputation on the Power and the Efficacy of Indulgences. And you must remember, in those days, if anyone wanted a debate, they will always nail the proposition on the door of the church. And this was what a debate that Martin Luther was calling for. Disputation on the power and efficacy of indulgences. And he had put 95 statements or propositions for this debate. Popular legend has it that on 31st October 1517, Luther defiantly nailed a copy of his 95 Theses to the door of the Wittenberg Castle Church. The reality was probably not so dramatic. Luther more likely hung the document on the door of the church to announce the ensuing academic discussion around it that he was organizing. Now, why did Luther choose October 31st and not any other day? You know what is 1st and 2nd November? And what is 30th October? 3 days of demonic practices. that take place. 30th October is known for Halloween's Day. First, I think is the All Saints Day, and then first is All Souls Day, and second is All Saints Day. And it could be the other way around too. People go to the grave, they whitewash the tombs, just like Jesus says so beautifully, they whitewash the tombs of the dead. They put garlands, light candles, as though that person is still there. Either that person is in hell or he is with the Lord. And if you look on 1st and 2nd November, 1st and 2nd November, you will see graveyards, Christian graveyards, filled with people. And it's like a jatra outside with flowers being sold, candles being sold, and whatnot. And one day in between these two or three traditions that the church was following was free. That was 31st October. And Martin Luther aptly picked up that day so that he could post these theses. Because 1st and 2nd November, people go to the graveyard to pray for the dead. And they hoped that they will go from purgatory to heaven. The 95 Theses, which would later become the foundation of the Protestant Reformation, were written in a remarkably humble and academic tone, questioning rather than accusing. the overall thrust of the document was nonetheless quite provocative. The first two of the theses contain Luther's central idea that God intended believers to seek repentance and that faith alone, not deeds, would lead to salvation. The other 93 theses, a number of them directly criticizing the practice of indulgences, supported these first two. In addition to his criticism of indulgences, Luther also reflected the popular sentiment about the St. Peter's scandal in the 95 theses. The 95 theses were quickly distributed throughout Germany and then made their way to Rome. In 1518, Luther was summoned to Augsburg, a city in southern Rome, Germany, to defend his opinion before an imperial diet or assembly. A debate lasting 3 days between Luther and Cardinal Thomas Cajetan produced no agreement. Cajetan defended the church's use of indulgences, but Luther refused to recant and return to Wittenberg. On November 9, 1518, the Pope condemned Luther's writing as conflicting with the teachings of the church. 1 year later, a series of commissions were convened to examine Luther's teaching. The first papal commission found them to be heretical, but the second merely stated that Luther's writing was scandalous and offensive to pious ears. That is true, because the pious ears are the goats. And Luther's writings are a joy and deliverance because the sheep always wanted to hear the gospel. Like the hymn writer wrote, "How sweet the name of Jesus sounds in a believer." Finally, in July 1520, Pope Leo X issued a papal bull, a public decree, that concluded that Luther's propositions were heretical and gave Luther 120 days to recant in Rome. Luther refused to recant, and on January 3, 1521, Pope Leo excommunicated Martin Luther from the Catholic Church. On April 17, 1521, Luther appeared before the Diet of Worms, or the Assembly of Worms at the place called Worms in Germany, refusing again to recant. And here we get Luther's most famous statement. Luther concluded his testimony with a defiant statement: "Here I stand, God help me, I can do no other. I cannot go against my conscience and against the word of God." On May 25th, the Holy Roman Emperor Charles V signed an edict against Luther, ordering his writings to be burnt. And Luther hid in the town of Eisenach for the next year, where he began work on one of his major life projects, the translation of the New Testament in German, which took him 10 years to complete. Luther returned to Wittenberg in 1521, where the Reformed movement initiated by his writing has gone beyond his influence. It was no longer a purely theological cause, it became political too. Other leaders stepped up to lead the reform, and concurrently, the rebellion known as Peasant War was making its way across Germany. Luther has previously written against the church's adherence to clerical celibacy, and in 1525 he married Catherine of Bora, a former nun. They had 5 children. Although Luther's early writings had sparked the Reformation, he was hardly involved in it during his later years. At the end of his life, Luther turned strident in his views and pronounced the Pope Antichrist, advocated for the expulsion of Jews from the empire, and condone polygamy based on the practice of patriarchs in the Old Testament. Luther, Martin Luther was one of the most influential figures in the Western history. His writings were responsible for fractionalizing the Catholic Church and sparking the Protestant Reformation. His central teaching that the Bible is the central source of religious authority and salvation is reached through faith and not deeds shaped the core of Protestantism. Although Luther was critical of the Catholic Church, he distanced himself from radical successors who took up his mantle. Luther is remembered as a controversial figure not only because of his writings, not only because his writings led to a significant religious reform and division, but also because in later life he took on a radical position on other questions, including his pronouncement against Jews. He called the Jews pigs, and he wanted them to be literally burned, which some had said may have pretended German anti-Semitism. And that is, and Hitler, Adolf Hitler, was a Jesuit priest. And could it have been that he looked at Martin Luther's writings and Germany was anti-Semitic? Could it have been that that led Hitler to kill 5 million Jews, 5 million plus Jews? Others dismissed them as just one man's vitriol that did not gain a following. Some of Luther's more significant contribution to theological history, however, such as his insistence that as a sole source of religious authority, the Bible be translated and made available to everyone, were truly revolutionary in his days. And God was so gracious that the printing press came into existence exactly at that time. And Gutenberg, who could print the first Bible. God was so gracious that everything came together to a point where people could have the Bibles in their hand, though it was expensive. And he was breaking every Roman Catholic tradition. Luther died on February 18, 1546. Now let's look at the 95 theses. And I'm not going to read all the 95 theses, but let's look at the first few. Luther begins actually by, let me give the introduction to it. The 95 theses, the common title to his disputation on the power and efficacy of indulgences, because this was a dispute that Luther had, a charge against the Roman Catholic Church on indulgences. So he says, what power does indulgences have? Or is it really efficacious in the life of a person, just holding a certificate? The Roman Catholic Church has not changed its stand even today. Even today, the indulgences are sold. There is a mass for people to be transferred from purgatory into heaven. they have not recanted of any of the evils that was there. In fact, they have grown and grown. Anyone who holds on to the doctrine of justification by faith alone is anathema to the Roman Catholic Church. Never say that the Roman Catholics are Christians. Is more widely associated with Luther's name than anything else he wrote. Luther posted his thesis on the castle door at Wittenberg on either 31st October or 1st November. And history says it was 31st October. The disputation which Luther announced never took place, but his challenge made him an overnight celebrity. Indulgences were being sold under the authority of Pope to raise money for various projects. The most recent spate of sales was being carried out by Archbishop Albert of Holzenheim, who needed cash to buy himself the Archbishopric of Mainz. And it is nothing new under the sun that even today, in CSI elections, people need money. They spend crores of rupees to become a bishop because they can earn that money back. The Roman Catholic bishop way back in the 13th, 14th, 15th century did the same thing. Half of the proceeds were to go to Albert and the other half to Pope Leo in Rome, where it would be used to help to build St. Peter's Cathedral. And this is what we are reading of the translation that is coming out from John Dillon, Dillenberger. He's the one who translated this into English from German that Martin Luther wrote. And this is what Martin Luther wrote. Out of love and concern for the truth. He begins with these words. Out of love and concern for the truth, and with the object of eliciting it, the following heads will be the subject of public discussion at Wittenberg under the presidency of the Reverend Father Martin Luther, Augustinian, Master of Arts and Sacred Theology, duly appointed lecturer on these subjects in his place, in that place. He requests that whoever cannot be present personally to the debate matter orally will do so in absence at writing. Will do so in absence at that writing. And he has these 95 points. And the first one he begins, which is so apt. When our Lord and Master Jesus Christ said, repent, he called for the entire life of believers to be one of penitence. And I will club both together, the first and the second. The word cannot be properly understood at referring the sacrament of penance, that is confession and satisfaction, as administered by the clergy. What does the word penance mean? Penance means one, a punishment inflicted on oneself as an outward expression of repentance for wrongdoing. Let me repeat. Penance is a punishment inflicted on oneself as an outward expression of repentance for wrongdoing. Two, penance is a sacrament in which a member of the Roman Catholic Church confesses sins to a priest and is given absolution. and is given absolution. You know, the Roman Catholic priest, if the even today people have to go to the confession box to confess the sins to the priest, and the priest will tell you to say 6 Our Fathers and 10 Hail Marys, or he will say go and give certain amount of money to the poor, or put some money in the hundi in the Roman Catholic Church, because the Roman Catholic Church is no better than Tirupati. Number one, Martin Luther rightly begins by saying, when our Lord, he says, our Lord and Master, because there is no other Lord and there is no other Master. There is, the Pope is not the Lord. The Archbishop of the local diocese is not the Lord. And he is not the Master of your soul. Only Jesus Christ. And he says, so when our Lord and Master Jesus Christ said, repent, Martin Luther says, he is called for an entire life of believers to be one of penitence. Why should our life be entirely a life of penitence? Because he knows very well, 1 John says, if any man says he is without sin, he is a liar and we sin constantly. One of the Puritans said, I'm forgetting his name. He says, man is born to a life of repentance, a life of continuous repentance. And if man is born to be repenting continuously, because his sin is being continuously exposed by the Holy Spirit in him, and he knows what he has done and what he has committed, he is always humbled, knowing where he is. Repentance, in one sense, causes a believer a brokenness, a humbleness, and a feeling of desperation. And that is when the believer, when he hears the gospel, he is uplifted. The gospel and repentance go hand in hand. They are like two tracks on a railway line that both are needed. Both are so needed. If you are constantly repenting without hearing the gospel of Jesus Christ, that is the power of God unto salvation, and that gospel brings you to a place where you are in Christ, that there is no condemnation. The repentance that you constantly repent of, if I can say, is a remorse feeling, and that will lead to damnation. But the repentance caused by the Spirit of God will also cause you to hear the gospel, to rejoice. And here, why is Martin Luther the first that he is putting forth his repentance? Because every one of them did abominable things. They worshipped relics. They gave all authority to the Pope, more than the Word of God. They made the Pope the representative of Jesus Christ on the earth. And what he says is the infallible word. They worship state saints. They were idolatrous, adulterous, blasphemous. And anyone coming out of that system has not, and it's like, it is so true that the scripture says there's no good things that indwells in us. So you have to repent. And the true repentance causes you to turn about, a 180 degrees turn from the practice that you were doing in the Roman Catholic Church, now to come under the authority of the scriptures and to do what the scripture says, even to this extent, not to fear for your life, because the Roman Catholic Church was atrocious in killing all the saints. Anyone who were against them, they killed them, they beheaded them. The blood that was shed by the Roman Catholic Church through the centuries is much more than those who lost their life in both World War I and World War II. The church is filled with the blood of the martyrs. Only today they are not able to kill, but they damn your soul. They damn your soul. Look at the second point. The word cannot be properly understood as referring the sacrament of penance, that is, confession and satisfaction as administered by the clergy. People do confessions. These are the sacraments for your penance, for your forgiveness, the infliction that you can take on what the clergy tells you. Number one, confession. Confession to whom? To a priest, not to Christ, who's our mediator, who's our advocate, whose blood forgives us. He's faithful and just to forgive all our sins, and his blood cleanses us. But rather, for them, it is the Our Fathers and the Hail Marys and the good works that they need to do. Even today, the Protestant Church has the same issue in another form. You have the local church, the pastor in the local church as almost equivalent to the Pope. His words have become infallible. And he says they do they make peace by giving money or a gift, and his prayers will be answered. The Reformation fought for another important doctrine, the priesthood of every believer. Every believer is a priest. How many of y'all have read the 95 Theses? And I think it will be good for us at least once in our lifetime to read these 95 Theses. If not, at least once a year. It's a good memory. It's a good thing to look at it, to see how our flesh tends to go back to some of the way. Though we may not be Roman Catholics, but still, we get the depraved flesh loves to see the works that the flesh does and think that they will be saved. At least once, just read the 95 Theses. Let me stop here. And Reformation led to the great truths that came out. We have the 5 points of Calvinism, TULIP, which was actually the summary of the canons of Dort. And then the solas, for which Reformation stood up to, the 5 solas, Scriptures alone, faith alone, grace alone, Christ alone, and for the glory of God alone. Luther was an imperfect man, yet God used them to bring out profound truths that you and I today have been so set free. The core of the Christian doctrine is justification by faith alone. You have been justified by Christ, and you have been set free. You have been set free. No works justify us. No good works will set us free. The just shall live by faith. Shall live by faith. Any questions?
Anna, I have a question. In 1517, when Martin Luther has brought up this 95 Theses, I heard that he's not yet saved at that point of time. Is that true?
Joel, basically people talk of what should I say? People talk on a specific date. I was I am saved on this day because I repented on this date. Some people can specify the date they were saved. Some people cannot specify the date that they are saved because God has been working in them constantly. Now my question to that is, if Martin Luther was not saved, how can he talk of such truths that have been revealed by only God can reveal such truth? If his heart is not regenerated, how can he accept such truths? You tell me.
Yes, Anna, but I heard it from another person that in 1519 he is reading Romans and then he talks about his conversion there. So just wanted to know.
I firmly believe Joel, there are 2-3 things, because I heard this argument many a time. See, it's an unconverted Martin Luther who posted that Martin Luther had only an intellectual understanding of the truth. So people today talk of, oh, he has the gospel in his head, not in his heart. But an elect is already chosen by God before the foundation of the world. And is already a child of God, even though he doesn't come to that realization. God is watching over him, and God's spirit is constantly restraining him on a particular day. He should be born to come into his kingdom. God allows it. Now, say for example, salvation is just like a child being in the womb. When is the child conceived? It's only a guess. When is a child conceived of new birth is guess. The child being fed, the child has heartbeat. Isn't it true of a Christian also?
Yes, Anna.
Whereas you and I will talk, okay, that person of publicly made a confession, so now only he is born again. But that process God has already started long time back.
Yeah. The vessels of mercy. He always.
Exactly. So. We always look for an external sign to say, okay, this person is saved or that person is saved. The Lord knows those who are his.